beginning on Friday the 20th of August. There's some leaflets at the back of the church if you'd like to pick one up to find out who the speakers are and what's happening. You do need to register, so inside the leaflet it will tell you where you need to go to register. Some of the things are online, I think some of them may be in person. As we come into God's presence, I ask you to push aside everything that's going in your mind that is not of God. That you still your heart, that you still your soul, that you still your mind. And for the next hour, come before God and focus truly on Him. Psalm 108 verses 1 to 5 says, "My heart, O God, is steadfast. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awake the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth." Let us stand and sing together, "Yet not I, but through Christ in me."
Thank you.
not through I that do the things, but through you who is in me. We praise you, God, for all that you have given us. We thank you for our health and strength to come here this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you are awesome. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have unwound us from the chains of our sin. We thank you, Father, that we can come into your presence and worship you. But yet, Lord, we know that we have done things that are not of your kingdom. We know that we have followed our selfish desires and our own ways throughout this week. We know, Lord, that we have disappointed, that we have let you down because we have let ourselves down. And in the silence of this moment, Lord, we all bring to you the things that we have done wrong, and we ask for your forgiveness. Hear our prayers, O Lord, in Jesus' name. So, today I have brought a little sheet. So last week, if you were here, you would have seen a bag of tricks, and we were talking about how God is at our core, or is God at our core, and do we put God at our core. This week, I'd like us to think about this verse from Matthew 19:26. Jesus said, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." This week we're going to be thinking about limits and limitations. And I wonder if you truly do believe this verse, that with all things it's possible with God. Has God called you to do something? Has God asked you to do something? Has God asked you to step out in faith? And are you coming up with lots of excuses? Are you saying, "I can't do that. I haven't got the skill to do that. I haven't got the ability to do that. I haven't got the time to do that. I can't do that." When we limit ourselves, we're limiting God. Now, you've probably noticed that there's a hole in this page, and you're maybe wondering why on earth has Francine put a hole in this page. Well, I've got this 10p. Now, when I was preparing this, I went looking in the house for some cash, but we've gone a wee bit cashless in our household with COVID, and I couldn't find any money. So when I went into my son's room, he had a little pot of old money. So for those of you who remember, this is an old 10p. So I would like to be able to put this 10p through this hole. But you can see that foolishly, I haven't actually made the hole big enough. If I wanted this 10p to go through this hole, the only way that I might be able to do it is to actually rip the sides and stick it through that way. Or so you would think. But if I do something to this page, if I change the hole slightly, just by folding it over. If I pop the 10p down there and then tweak it, the 10p goes through without even having to rip the hole. And you know, you and I are a bit like that. When God asks us to do something, we see all the things that stop us from doing it, but we don't see how God sees. I'm sure that none of you knew that if I folded over this page, that if I popped the 10p in there and tweaked it a little bit, that 10p was going to come through. I knew that because someone else had told me that that was going to work. So I had to step out of faith and try it for myself, and it worked. What about you? When God calls you to do something, do you step out of faith? Because God sees everything. He sees what's going to happen in the future. He knows that you can do these things because everything is possible with God if you truly believe it. Don't put limits on yourself, because when you put limits on yourself, you are limiting our God, and we can't limit God. We're here, we're called to do what God asks us to do, and nothing is impossible with Him. The next time that you hear God calling you to do something, asking you to do something that you feel is just maybe a wee bit out of your skill set, Remember the tenth plague. And remember that the tenth was able to go through the hole because it just changed a little bit. The shape of the hole changed a little bit, shaped it a little bit, and it was a possible thing to do. In the same way with God, things will be possible. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I ask that you will help us all to have faith in your promise that all things are possible through you. Help us to have the strength to step out in faith. That can be a scary step, but the adventure with you, Lord, is amazing, and one very often that we would never expect to go on. Give us that faith, Lord, and help us to remember again, all things are possible through you. Amen. Let us stand and sing, "Give Me Oil in My Lamp." Well, that you will bring Christians into their lives and they will hear more about you and have more of an understanding and come into your kingdom. Heavenly Father, I thank you for our ministers who serve us faithfully throughout the year. We thank you, Father, that they are able to take time in the summer to renew their spirits and to gain strength. We ask, Lord, as many of them are coming back from holiday, that you will be with them in these weeks ahead as they plan for the new autumn session. Lord, church again may look different. And we ask, Lord, that they will listen to your Holy Spirit, that they will think upon what it is that you want them to do. And we ask, Lord, that they will step out in faith, that they will remember that nothing is impossible with you. And Lord, that we, their congregation, will support them, that we will also hear your Holy Spirit and know what the right direction is to go there in this next season coming. And Heavenly Father, as we listen to the news, we hear about Afghanistan, Lord, and the terrible things that are happening there. Lord God, it is so dangerous for Christians to live in Afghanistan, but now with the Taliban taking over so much of the country, we ask, Lord, that you will be with them. Send your Holy Spirit to them and uplift them and strengthen them. And Father, I ask that when they come across Taliban soldiers, that they will show them your love and your peace, that they will see something that is different in your servants, Lord, and their hearts will be changed. Lord, this is a terrible situation. So many people are leaving and going into other countries that haven't even got the resources to support them. Heavenly Father, I just pray your Spirit into that country. I pray your Holy Spirit into the government. I pray your Holy Spirit into the army that is trying to defend those people. Be there, Lord, and help them. And Lord, as we hear the terrible news of Haiti and the earthquake that has happened there with 300 people, Lord, who have died, so many persons who are injured. Lord God, I ask that you will be with those families who have lost their loved ones, who have lost a brother, a sister, a father, a mother. Support them in this terrible time. And Lord, for the workers who are trying to find people, maybe who are buried under the rubble, Lord God, I ask that you will direct them, that you will guide them to those people who are still alive, Lord, and needing rescue. Lord, be with the Christians who are in Nigeria. Show them, Lord, how to help, how to serve, how to love in this situation. Haiti, Lord, is being in such turmoil already. We just ask, Father, that your people will bring peace and will serve those who need it. And Lord, we ourselves know many who are suffering. People within our families, people within our family and friend circle, people within our community. And in these few moments of silence, we bring to you those people who are suffering through illness, or relationship problems, or unemployment, or financial difficulties, whatever it may be, Lord, we bring them to you. We thank you, Father, that we can hold on to your promise that when two or three are gathered in your name, you hear and you answer our prayers. Thank you, God. Amen. So last week we had started to hear a little bit about Esther. This week we are continuing on with Esther chapter 3 and 4. So just like last week, it will take 5 or so minutes to read through chapters 3 and 4. So Esther chapter 3. After these events, King Xerxes honored Haman, the son of Hamath, the Agagite, elevating him and giving him a seat of honor higher than any of the other nobles. All the royal officials at the king's gate knelt down and paid honor to Haman. would not kneel down or pay him honour.
Then the royal official at the king's gate asked Mordecai, "Why do you disobey the king's command?"
Day after day, they spoke to him, but he refused to comply.
Therefore, they told Haman about it, to see whether Mordecai's behaviour would be tolerated, for he had told them that he was a Jew.
When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honour, he was enraged.
Yet having learnt who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all of Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes.
In the 12th year of King Xerxes, in the first month of Nisan, the Pur, that is the lot, was cast in the presence of Haman to select the day and the month. The lot fell on the 12th month, the month of Adar. Then Haman said to King Xerxes, "There is a certain people dispersed among the peoples throughout all the provinces of your kingdom who keep themselves separate. Their customs are different from those of all the other peoples, and they do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's best interest to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued to destroy them, and I will give 10,000 talents of silver to the king's administration for the royal treasury." So the king took his signet ring from his finger and gave it to Haman, son of Hamadath, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews. "Keep the money," the king said to Haman, "and do with the people as you please." Then on the 13th day of the first month, the royal secretaries were summoned. They wrote out in the script of each province and in the language of each of the people all Haman's orders. He said to the strapets, the governors, and the various provinces, to the nobles of the various people. These were written in the name of King Xerxes himself, and sealed with his own ring. Dispatches were sent out by couriers to all the king's provinces with the order to destroy, kill, and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and children, on a single day, on the 13th day of the 12th month, the month of Adar, and to plunder all their goods. A copy of the text of the Lib was issued as law in every province and made known to the people of every nation so that they would be ready for that day. The couriers went out, spurred on by the king's command, and the edict was issued in the citadel of Susa. The king and Haman sat down to drink, but the city of Susa was bewildered. When Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went out into the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. But he went only as far as the king's gate, because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter. In every province to which the edict and order of the king came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing, many lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's eunuchs and female attendants came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress. She sent clothes for him to put on instead of the sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to attend her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city, in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened to him, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. He also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for their annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show Esther and
to beg for mercy and plead for him and her people. Having gone back, I reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, all the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one oath, that they be put to death, unless the king extends the gold scepter to them and spares their lives. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to the royal position for such a time as this. Then Esther sent a reply to Mordecai, go. Gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. And I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it's against the law. And if I perish, I will perish. So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I ask that you will open up the hearts and the minds of everyone who is here this morning to hear you talk, Lord, that they will be transformed into the way that you want us to be. Amen. Well, last week we were introduced to some of the key characters in the story, King Xerxes, Esther, and Mordecai. This week, we come face to face with the villain, Haman. There are some key facts that we need to know about Haman in order to understand his hatred for the Jews. In verse 1 of chapter 3, we are told that Haman was an Agagite. This means that he was a descendant of Agag and the king of the Amalekites. The Amalekites were the ancient enemies of the Jews. They were descended from Malachi, the grandson of Esau. They were a fierce nomadic tribe that lived in the desert region of the Dead Sea. They killed for pleasure, and they were one of the first groups of people to attack the Israelites after they had left Egypt. We're now just going to take a few moments to trace the history of the Israelites and the Amalekites, starting in Exodus 17. Which describes this first attack. The Amalekites came and attacked the Israelites at Ramadan. Moses said to Joshua, choose some of our men and go out to fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with my staff of God in my hands. So Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. And Moses, Aaron and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held out his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side and one on the other, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with his sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered, and make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Malachi from under heaven. Moses built an altar, and he called it, the Lord is my banner. He said, because hands were lifted up against the throne of the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. Later on in Deuteronomy, we learn that as a result of the attack on God's chosen people, God says to Moses in Deuteronomy 25:19, when the Lord your God gives you rest
from all your enemies around you in the land he is giving you to possess as an inheritance. You shall blot out the name of Malachi from under heaven. Do not forget. King Saul was given the task of wiping out the Amalekites. In 1 Samuel 15 and 3, he is given these instructions. Now go, attack the Amalekites, and totally destroy all that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men and women, children and infants, cattle and sheep, camels and donkeys. But Saul does not do what God has instructed him. He defeats the Amalekites, but he doesn't destroy everything. The king of the Amalekites is captured and brought to Saul, and the best sheep and cattle are kept. Samuel the prophet goes to confront Saul about this, but he lies to him. And when he tells him that all of the Lord's instructions have been carried out, Samuel says to him, well, what's this bleating that I can hear? As a result of his blatant disobedience, God rejects Saul as king over Israel, and Samuel kills Agag, the king of the Amalekites. The ancient readers of the story of Esther would have known this and understood from the outset that Haman and Mordecai would be enemies. When it comes to Haman's attention that Mordecai is refusing to bow down to him and that he is a Jew, he is not satisfied with killing only him, but he is determined to wipe out the entire nation of the Jews that live in the Persian Empire. He is so confident that he will be able to do this that he selects the month and the day that this will happen by casting lots, before he even brings the idea to the king. And the king doesn't question Haman's suggestion or try to discover who these people are. By giving Haman his ring, he gives him the power to do whatever he wants. So the decree is written and sent out to all the provinces that on the 13th day of the 12th month, all the Jews similar to a law being written today that states on the 13th of December all Christians are to be killed. How would that make you feel? What questions would be running through your mind? What would you do? How would you react? Mordecai, when he hears of what's being decreed, tears his clothes, puts on sackcloth and ashes, and wails loudly and bitterly as he goes as far as the king's gate. He can go no further than this, as no one clothed in sackcloth is allowed to enter. Obviously, Esther has not heard what has been decreed, as she seems to be totally oblivious to what is going on. When she's told about the state that Mordecai is in, she's distressed and doesn't understand why he won't accept the clothes that she sent him. She's not allowed to leave the harem, so she sends out Caliph to find out what is troubling Mordecai. He explains everything to her, gives a copy of the decree, and told him to urge Esther to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. Esther may be queen, but she has no part. No one is allowed to go into the presence of the king unless he is called, even his queen. Esther's first response to what Mordecai has asked her to do is one of fear, powerlessness, and limitation. There's no way she can come into the king's presence. The king has not called her in the last 30 days. She is not on his mind. To go before him could mean death. And that is what she sends as a reply to Mordecai. Mordecai is very blunt with her. As he states, don't think just because you live in the king's house, you're the one Jew that will get out of this alive. If you persist in staying silent at a time like this, help and deliverance will arrive for the Jews from someplace else, but you and your family will be wiped out. Who knows? Maybe you were made queen for such a time as this. Through the words of Mordecai, is beginning to understand why her life nation became for the lives of her people. No one else can do this. Even though 4 years have passed since she was made queen, she can see now God's plan. So she has a choice. Mordecai's words are clear. You've been chosen to do this work for God, but if you refuse, the Jews will be saved in another way, but you will perish. So she can do nothing and risk her life, or she can go to the king and risk her life. This is the turning point in the story. Esther hears the call of God and she steps into his plan. Have you heard God calling you to do something specific in your life? If you have, what have you done about it? Is God calling you right now to do something that you feel you do not have the ability to do, the desire to do, or the right to do? I've been there. When God first called me into the ministry, I did not have the desire to do it. I did not feel that I had the right to do it or the ability to do it. I could begin my story in 2013 when God and I had the first serious conversation about me going into the ministry. But I now realise that it began long before that. As a child, I loved holiday Bible clubs, the scripture classes at GB, questioning and exploring the Bible that was taught in youth fellowship. As I got older, I enjoyed teaching in the holiday Bible clubs, in the Sunday schools, in GB and Liam YF. I had a desire to study theology, and if I hadn't realised that I could have studied theology and then become an RE teacher, that is the route that I would have taken. This desire to study theology never left, and in the end, God very clearly told me in 2013 and said, "Why do you think you have such a desire to study theology? Is it just for your own benefit?" And with that question, I knew what he was asking me to do. At that point, I couldn't even write the word minister in my journal. I did not want to be one. What would I have to say to people? Why would they want to listen to me? How could I pastor and help them? God told me that it wasn't for them and that I would know when the correct time was. In May 2019, God clearly told me that now was the time to begin my journey into ministry. And over the 6 intervening years, when we first had that conversation, I could now see how God had been preparing me. He led me into leadership within my school, preparing me for leadership within the church. He sent me to India with Christian Aid, and when I returned, I was expected to share what I had learnt in many different churches. I thought I'd be talking from the front, but most churches I visited wanted me to talk from the pulpit. Then Christian Aid asked if I would use their sermon material to preach in various churches coming up to Christian Aid Week. I agreed to do this, and I realised that I could do it. It wasn't so scary. I hadn't seen it at the time, but God had been preparing me. One of the things that God has taught me over these last 2 years is not to put limitations on myself. When I limit myself, I'm limiting God. I was reading a book recently that had this quotation from Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. He said, "It is our duty as men and women to proceed as though the limits of our abilities do not exist." Listen to that again. It is our duty as men and women to proceed as though the limits of our abilities do not exist. I was putting limitations on God when I thought I couldn't do this. And in fact, I was right. I can't do this. On my own, without God, I am nothing. I do not have the ability, the skills, or the strength to do this work. But praise God, I am not on my own. And I hold on to what it says in Philippians 4:13. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. So are you putting limits on yourself? And therefore, Satan wants us to believe that we do not have the ability to do what God wants us to do. He wants us to limit ourselves, to remain tethered to the ground, and not soar over the power of the Holy Spirit living within us. Perhaps you're not a Christian, but you hear God calling you into the kingdom. You want to respond, but you feel that you're not good enough, holy enough, or that you would never be able to live the life of a Christian. None of us are good enough, holy enough, or able to live the life that God has called us to by ourselves. Once we have committed ourselves to God, His Holy Spirit lives within us. God gives us the ability to shed the mold of this world and to live as a citizen of His kingdom. As I said last week, it is a lifelong journey, and there will be plenty of bumps and crashes on the way. But Isaiah 41:10 gives us hope. Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And as Jesus said in Matthew, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Whatever it is that God is asking you to do, or will ask you to do, do not fear. God is with you, and He will give you the ability to do it. Step into His plan, just as Esther did. Esther knew that God wanted her to go before the king and plead for the lives of His people, but she didn't do it right away. We learned last week that Esther was a woman who had God at her core, and we can see that in what she did next. She instructs Mordecai to gather together all the Jews of Susa and to fast and pray for 3 days. She and her maids will do the same. Although her first reaction was one of fear, when she thought through her options and perhaps why she was now queen, she knew she could do nothing without first coming to God in fasting and prayer. God is calling you. He is asking you to step out into faith, just like He did with Esther. The lives of God's chosen people were in the hands of Esther. As a child of God, she knew she could do nothing without God. She turned to Him, she asked for His help, but she didn't do it alone. She enlisted the help of all the Jews in Susa and her handmaidens. Is that our first reaction when God is calling us to do something that we feel inadequate to do? To fast and to pray? I would say that most of us, if we are Christians, would pray and bring our concerns before God. I know for me, fasting would not be something I would automatically do, but I believe that God is calling us to include this into our spiritual disciplines. When I was preparing my sermon, I heard God telling me to include fasting, and my reaction was, really, God? But through my preparations, I can see that this is something that we should be doing on a regular basis. Fasting is throughout the Bible, and we know that Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Yet is it something that Christians are still expected to do? And the answer to that question is yes. Although we're not commanded to fast, Jesus expected His followers to do it. The Bible clearly indicates that Jesus expected fasting to be part of the lives of His disciples. In Matthew 9, 14 and 15, for instance, Jesus promises that His disciples would engage in fasting once His earthly ministry had come to a close. In Matthew 6, 16, He says to His disciples, when or as often as you fast. He did not say if you fast. I don't want to be presumptuous, but I would reckon that many of you here are like me and have not really given a lot of thought to fasting. So let's examine two questions. First, what is fasting? And second, how do you do it? Fasting is a discipline of abstaining from something good, like food, social media, TV, shopping, so that we can concentrate our spiritual lives and find satisfaction while fasting, we are one and one with God, offering him the time and attentiveness we might otherwise be given to eating, to shopping, or watching TV. It's a small step of self-denial. When fasting, we must use the time intentionally to come into God's presence. If you've decided to miss lunch, then the time that you would usually use for preparing and eating food is the time that you give to God. There is no point in fasting if you don't use the time to come into God's presence. So how do we go about fasting? Focus on the Family, in their online article about fasting as a spiritual discipline, has some good suggestions about what to do in time of fasting. Number one, bring your Bible and a glass of water during your fast. Secondly, relax and breathe deeply. Place yourself into the presence of God. Offer yourself and your time to God by repeating Samuel's words, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening," or simply saying, "Here I am." Thirdly, spend some time worshipping God and thanking him for his faithfulness. Thank him for where he has come through for you. Number four, bring your desires to God. Ask him if this desire is in line with his will and his word for you and the church. Be still and listen. Offer your desires and prayers to God. And lastly, I think it's a good idea to journal or write down some of the conversations that you have with God. I would suggest that if you've never fasted before, that you maybe start by doing it once a month. Be mindful and plan when you do it. Look at your calendar, choose a date and decide what it is that you will fast from. Put a reminder in your calendar that this is what you're doing. Fasting is between you and God. No one else should know about it. In Matthew 6:16-18, Jesus says, "When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." If you're interested in beginning to fast, complete some research on the internet. To begin with, you can type into a search engine, "Focus on the Family Fasting," and the article that I used will come up. It's an interesting article, and it will give you some ideas to think about. Last week, I asked you to consider what is at your core. This week, I asked you to think, are you limiting God by limiting yourself? Remember, whatever God asks you to do, you do not do it alone, but in his strength. And as it says in Esther, who knows, maybe you were made for just such a time as this. Secondly, is fasting something that you would contemplate doing? If it is, plan when you will do it this week and complete a little bit of research in preparation for it. Through these four chapters of Esther, we have seen a young orphan girl grow and develop. When we were first introduced to her, she was a victim of her circumstances, brought into a pagan palace, married to a pagan king with no voice. Yet she found favor with all that she met, because I believe she had God at her core. Mordecai told her that she has to save her people, and she has chosen to step up to the challenge. She knows that she does not have to do this alone, and she turns to God to help formulate a plan that will stop her and her people from being slaughtered. When I'm invited back, maybe in some time in October, we will find out what that plan is and what happens to Esther and her people. However, if you can't wait that long, then perhaps you could read the rest of the story for yourself. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, remind us daily that nothing is impossible through you, that we are able to do all things through you who gives us the strength, power, and ability to do them. Lord, Let us pray.